यस
यस चेतन
यस
सर, चेतन इन द मीन टाइम प्लीज स्टार्ट विद द इंट्रोडक्शन एंड देन वील टेक द प्रोग्राम फर्दर. साना प्लीज स्टार्ट विद द इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ द स्पीकर. सर वंस अगेन वेलकम एंड थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर एक्सेप्टिंग अवर इन्विटेशन. नाउ ओवर टू यू साना, प्लीज इंट्रोड्यूस द स्पीकर टूडे. थैंक यू.
Firstly, on behalf of Bar Association of Maharera Mumbai, I welcome all the participants for this webinar. Today, we have Senior Advocate Mr. Rajiv Patil with us, who will enlighten us on the topic professional ethics. It is my privilege to introduce a versatile personality like Mr. Rajiv Patil. Since his college days, he has been at the forefront of many judicious causes. Before practicing law, sir was a freelance journalist with prominent magazines and newspapers like Sakal, Saptahik Dinank, Saptahik Lok Prabha. Sir acquired his master's degree in property law and criminal law from Mumbai University. He started practicing law since September 1982. In 1983, he joined the chambers of late Mr. Justice Vilas Kamath. When his senior, Justice Kamath, was elevated as judge of the Bombay High Court in 1989, sir started his own independent law practice. Thereby, he practiced law in almost all legal fields like constitutional law, civil, criminal, industrial law, and family law. He conducted very important cases like writ petitions in the matters of gut agreement, Dunkel proposals, Enron projects, and is continuing to conduct the Tarapur rehabilitation case also. In 1996, sir was appointed as the additional public prosecutor by the state of Maharashtra at Bombay High Court. He was unanimously elected as chairman of Bar Council of Maharashtra and Goa in 2008. Thereafter, to honor his contribution to the field of law, he was designated as senior advocate in the year 2012. Sir was the faculty member in KC College of Law, where he taught Criminal Procedure Code and Evidence Act. Even now, he continues to impart knowledge as a faculty member on the panel of Bombay High Court for regional conferences of judicial officers. Sir, we welcome you to this webinar session.
Thank you, Sana. Can I start?
Yes, sir. Please, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Good afternoon, friends. Very nice to see you, all of you, in this fourth lockdown forced on us. But we have to survive as an advocate, no doubt about it. Everyone is suffering from wrongful confinement, and that is how we come across each other by this webinar. To update ourselves with various subjects. Thanks to Mr. Harshad Bhadbade and Mr. Chetan and Sana for giving me this opportunity on behalf of practitioners practicing on the RERA authorities. And I'm given a subject, or I'm expected to speak on the subject of professional etiquettes, ethics, and misconduct. Speaking on this subject, normally nobody speaks on this subject. Speaking on this subject is like giving a sermon how to behave properly in the society, or tell you something that how to behave properly in a Ram Rajya, or how to be in a very nice person to all the other parts of your society. I'm sure that though this subject is of the way, it's not exactly the law which you are practicing or you learned during your law education. When you were enrolled as an advocate or an advocate with your bar council, you were given a little booklet, a white booklet, And nobody looks at that booklet, what it is exactly. You just frame the sanad in your chambers and keep that booklet away without considering what it is. Normally, this booklet is titled as Professional Etiquettes, Rules of Professional Etiquettes, Ethics and Misconduct. I don't know whether you have read, anybody of you read this booklet at any point of time. And we do read this booklet when there is a complaint in the Bar Council against someone and you have to defend them. Because you have to study what is the Section 35 and what is the misconduct and whatever it may be. Yes, we are going to talk about etiquettes, ethics, conduct or misconduct. I expect all my audience over here is on young advocates and they are trying their level best to be a best successful advocate in their career. So therefore, when I was asked to give some inputs about this, I came across an article which was written by none other than Mr. Fali Nariman, a senior most advocate in India. And way back in sometime in 2013, he gave a good lecture to young advocates, giving them the 10 types of advices. He said that if at all you are a young advocate, you have to keep it in mind 10 points when you start your career. It's like if you have chosen a law practice in court as your career, the first thing is that you be the regular in the court, whether you have work or not, attend the court regularly and keep your mind very, very well alert. Number two is that attend your court when you don't have a work. Attend your court when you don't have a work means you sit in the court and not in a bar association and see what's going on in the court. Number three is that waiting period in this profession is very long and you need to have your patience. It's like nowadays you must have realized it that it's like waiting for an appeal or suit coming to the final hearing. And it takes a long time in your career. Number four, he said, that know your judge very well. Now, what does it mean, know your judge very well? It's not that you have to party with him, but it's in a very sincere way that you have to attend the court. You don't have to lose your court as such. And you should know what judge is expecting from you while you are dealing with the case. If at all you want to be a very successful advocate, be a good advocate with watchful eyes. You have to have good eyes and good ears. Whatever is going around in the court and you can see, you can hear, which may develop your experience. And further, you can learn how the court proceeds on its own. What are the queries of the court judge? What is the mood of the judge? How you are developing your arguments? In all this, you don't have to show that you are something different as such. Don't show off. You can, as humble as possible, to present your case. And most important fact is, don't be so funny in the court. It's of no use cracking jokes every now and then and be funny or make fun of yourself. You can be a bold, no doubt about it. You being an advocate, officer of the court, you can be bold. But you should never lose your temper at any point of time, whether you are a junior most or you are a senior most. Your advocacy depends on your temperament, and that is how you are going to be known as an advocate of your court. Now, after this, let us come to the subject of etiquettes and ethics. When we talk about the professional etiquettes or ethics, we talk about goodness. We talk about politeness. We talk about humbleness or courtesy. Normally speaking, etiquettes are conventional, unwritten rules of social or customary or polite behavior or conduct when you are moving in court, in the society, and in the public as a legal professional. It is very important that your etiquettes as an advocate are very important. Ethics is the another term which is used in our profession, is that these are the set of moral principles which you need to observe while conducting yourself as an advocate. Now, after this etiquettes and ethics, the issue of conduct or misconduct comes in. And it is said that misconduct is an act of improper or unprofessional behavior or actions you take which you are not befitting yourself as an advocate, and therefore it's an action which is punishable. Now, I'm not going to read the sections and case laws. It is for you to read it. But I can just give you one idea that please read section 35 of the Advocates Act. It speaks about the professional conduct as well as misconduct as well as the other misconduct. Now, there is a distinction between two. Professional misconduct on one part and the other misconduct on the other part. You being an advocate, you are expected because you have different status in the society, and you are expected to follow all the norms of your profession to be very decent as such. You are an advocate who speaks on behalf of the client, who speaks in favor, who recommends, who advises, who appears in court, argues the matter, who pleads for client, defend their clients. And in many ways, you are the person who is responding to your client's legal rights in the court of law. One thing my young friend should know and remember always, that India is the country where its freedom struggle was led by the legal professionals, advocates. They were all advocates. Almost all of them were advocates. And they have different status since the independence movement. Even your creator of a constitution of India, which is the best document in the world, this document, to creation of this document was led by an advocate, and therefore you have different status in the society, you being an advocate, and you have special privileges being an advocate. One more thing I would like to remind you here is this, that 70% of the population of this country is rural population. They are not in the cities. They are in the rural areas. And all of them, I don't know about the, everybody may have a different opinion about the urban areas, but so far as the rural areas are concerned, they have ultimate faith in the judiciary or the judicial process or system in India. They believe in judicial process. And their faith is expected to be maintained by persons like us, advocates. As they have tremendous faith, any client, whether it's a rural or urban, whenever a client approach you for their problem, they have tremendous trust in you. They feel that you are the only person who is the right person to guide them on the right path in their legal battles. They believe you in entirety. They don't hide anything from you, as you are soulless to them. Maintain their faith. It is very important to maintain their faith in you as well as in judicial system. Let us not, any of us, create any dilemma in their mind about your status or our status as an advocate. For them, you are a pathfinder, a beacon, a guide, a friend, a trustee, advisor, counsel, whatever you call it. You are great support of the last resort to them. As I said earlier, that when you got enrolled as an advocate, you were given a white booklet by the Bar Council about the rules of etiquettes and conduct. I would only say that these are the rules which are framed under Section 49 of the Advocates Act 1960. And each and every advocate should read these rules for their own benefit, because these are very important rules which talk so many things about the profession. It's a legal profession which is supposed to be the noble profession. I don't know how many of you believe in this, but I still believe that it's a noble profession. When we talk about the conduct, misconduct, etiquettes, or ethics, the most relevant part or most important part, there are five types of duties which you need to keep in mind. There are duties towards the court, duties towards the client, duties towards the opponent, duties towards your fellow advocates, and one more which I normally add in my sessions is duties towards the society. I must also tell you that how come I like this subject? I like this subject simply because when I was associated with the Bar Council for long years, I came across so many cases of misconduct which took place simply because of unawareness of many advocates about these rules or conduct or Section 35 of the Advocates Act. Just keep it in mind, this is a profession which in which you never retire. I remember there is a recent episode which happened in the Supreme Court sometime back when Mr. Ram Jethmalani was very much alive. And he was asked by the Chief Justice of India, Mr. Jethmalani, when you are going to retire. And immediately just Mr. Jethmalani answered, why you are asking me my date of my death? He was very blunt to tell the court that he is going to practice law till his death. Never mind whether your health permits to continue with law or not, or court or not, but you remain an advocate till you are in a position to advise your clients or till you survive as such. Now let us come back to the duties. As I said earlier, the most important duty, which according to me is the duty towards the court. As I said, advocates never retire. He goes on practicing law till he is dropped dead. He accumulates the knowledge by his experience, and therefore it is must for you to know your judge. As I said earlier, know your judge. Know your judge in an ethical sense. It is not necessary that you have to mingle with the judges for all the time for whatever reasons. I am saying in a sense that I suppose that all of you are from the different fields. Most of you are from real estate area or of law. And you face the judges who come from different background. Each judge is different. His knowledge is different. His experience is different. Addressing judge in a court is also sometimes become a very important for the judge as well as for you. If I remember correctly, the great philosopher Socrates once said, he said in terms of orator, but it is befitting the advocates. He said that the orator does not teach the judges and juries about right and wrong. He merely persuades them. So it is for you who is appearing before the judge to persuade the judge to place your client's case before the judge and persuade him to grant reliefs in your client's favor. It's in a public good as such. When you are an advocate, you are first officer of the court. An officer of the court means you are duty bound towards the court to be independent and perform your duties as an officer of the court. You may be argumentative, you may be inquisitive, indignant or apologetic, but you should, as an advocate, you should be in a position to or ready to accept criticism against you as such, because it's very important. You can't get annoyed by any of the criticism on you. It may ultimately help you in develop your art of persuasion. You need not identify yourself with your client. You need not lie to the court for the purpose of getting some kind of a benefit for your client. You should not also browbeat in the court, and don't play to the gallery in the court. I have seen many persons that instead of arguing before the judge, they play for the gallery and look at the gallery, what kind of a response they get from the gallery. We have to keep it in mind that it is for the judge to appreciate and not the gallery. If judge appreciates your point, you will be the best advocate. The gallery may be for you for all the time to come. You can reserve it for whatever reasons, but you owe a duty towards the court. You have to be very humble, courteous, show your respect, and be properly dressed. Recently, I came across a news item in Times of India that as during the lockdown, that somebody appeared before the judge in a baniyan. Judge got, it's happened in Rajasthan, but judge got very upset about the appearance. You are really, it concerns so many things. When you are an advocate, you are appearing before the court, you are expected to nicely dressed, properly dressed. You may not wear expensive coat or whatever it may be, but you should be nicely, cleanly appear before the court, and your appearance should be pleasing. Never take a coat for granted. Many people chew tobacco and go to court, chew pan and go to court. It is not expected from an advocate. I remember one of my experience that I was engaged in my very junior days. I was assisting a senior who was in, it was a criminal trial against the chief minister of Maharashtra at that time. I'm talking about 1983-84. At that time, one of our senior advocate was, he was in a habit of chewing pan, and the judge was a Parsi. He never liked his red face or red mouth as such. And whatever even he argued the best point of it, he never appreciated it. So you leave your habits outside the court, be a presentable, be a nice person with all the courtesies, and you will see the result as such. You are expected to argue law before the court. You are expected to place the facts of your client's case perfectly before the court. And that is the duty you owe towards the court. Court accepts your every statement simply because you are an advocate. You are not a common man as such. Your word is taken seriously by the judge. Your word is taken with all the weightage, and therefore it is very necessary for you to maintain all the decorum of the court. I won't read out to you what are the rules as such. It is for you to read section 35 and the rule book of the Bar Council which is given to you. Now let us come to the duty towards the clients. Duty towards the client means, once again, you are an advocate, you are a legal wizard for your client. He feels that you are the best person in the world. Apna advocate bahut acha hai. He will be giving me an advice which cannot be compared with anything else. Because he believes you like that. This kind of a confidence he has in you, and therefore it is very important not to compromise with this confidence of your client. You may read his case. You may advise him whatever it stand, whatever his status is, legal status is. And you have to be very frank enough to tell your client that what kind of a relief he is in a position to get if at all he goes approach the court of law. You don't have to guarantee any results because you are not the person who is going to buy or you are going to give anything to your client. You are going to persuade some third person and try to get best reliefs from the court in favor of your client. And therefore, it is very necessary for you to be clear, be blunt, and tell your client that this is what his case is, and maximum what are the follies, what are the good points in his case, but never ever give any kind of a guarantee to the client that I can get this order for you. There are many advocates in young days, they also feel that, wow, what a case you have. The law is with you, the Supreme Court has laid down this law, the High Court had said this in this case, everything is with you, and therefore you are bound to win. But mind well, my friends, each of the case has its own merits. Each of the case has different facts. It is not a kind of a stock. You go into the market, buy the thing and give it to your client. You persuade the court that these are the rights of your client, and you are trying to place the best of your presentation before the court, and you advise him in a very legal manner. It's a legal manner in the sense that unless you tell him in a very legal manner that what kind of a case he has, he won't be in a position to understand that where he stands, and never keep him in a fool's paradise that, oh, you have a best case, kuch bhi hoga, karke dunga. Most of you are practicing in a property matter and you feel that your client has a good case. But you can tell your client that you have a good case, but you will try your level best to get a particular kind of a relief which you are asking for. So you develop the confidence in him, and his confidence is best for you, and he remains with you for all the time, even if he fails in any case, because you have given him the best of the advice within the framework of law. Frank opinion does not matter. I mean, it doesn't hurt anybody, but it makes very clear to each of your client that yes, where he stands as such. Neither I am not expecting you, any of you, to do this, but there is a kind of a trend which comes along with, after every 12 years, after every generation, it comes with that particular thing. Now there is a kind of a management practice. I can manage this, I can manage that, I can give you a package. It's a package deal nowadays it is being offered. And no, I am not with this kind of a idea. It can't be a package deal. You are not in a market. You are not a service provider. You are a professional. You are a law professional. So therefore, never get indulged into it, because it will take you nowhere. You can't be the best advocates because of your management skills. You can manage your office, streamline your office, no problem. But never try to manage the court. It's not going to help you at all. Communication with your client is very important. It's a very privileged communication. He explains to you everything. And this communication is really privileged communication within the meaning of Evidence Act. And therefore, whatever he tells you, it's his private affair. Don't tell these affairs to your wife, your girlfriend, your friend, your mother, or whoever it may be close to you, because your client has expressed some kind of a confidence in you, and in that confidence he has told you that what is his case, what he has done in his entire case. It's not that you have to ask your client really you have committed a murder or whether he has really committed a crime. It's not your job. Your job is that read his case and try to give him best possible relief which you can get. Keep it in mind that many advocates, sometimes a serious sensational case takes place. in your area, in your locality, and all of a sudden some bar association takes a decision, nobody will defend this person. Bar association take decision, no advocate should take up this case. Sorry, sirs, I am not with this idea at all, because in our profession it is said that even devil has a right to defend. Even devil comes to you, you need not look into his devilish act. But if at all it is available to you that to give him advice, please do it. You can't refuse an advice, a legal advice, to a person who is in need of it. And therefore, it is necessary for you to conduct your client's case on merits, and you may be a successful advocate in this profession. Now let us come to the duties towards your opponent. In our area of profession, like property matters, Mumbai and Pune, they are large metropolis. But there are some areas beyond Pune, beyond Mumbai, which are very small areas and very small legal community practice in that area. So therefore, you have to maintain the respect towards your opponent. Opponent means there are two persons in when I say opponents. Your client's opponent, who is a defendant or the plaintiff, whoever he may be, and your opponent's advocate. You are an advocate, you know law very well, and therefore you have to maintain the respect towards the opponent. You never tell your client's opponent that tumhare vakil ko kuch bhi nahi aata. There is sometime an habit of at some places that they just ridicule the other side advocate in presence of their client, and they try to impress their client. It doesn't going to help anything. Never tell your client's opponent that you have a useless case and he will not going to win at any point of time. Maintain his respect. He is equally in the court. He is equally taking legal advice, and his advocate is also a law graduate. He has also learnt a law along with you, before you or after you, wherever it is, but he has learnt law, and he also knows the law as equal. You studied in your college days and you studied in your profession in the courts. If you are a best advocate, you can maintain this kind of a relationship. If at all, I'll just come to the point where you feel like your client, instead of going into the litigation, should resolve the issue instead of fighting in the court. You can be a best mediator, no problem. Take in confidence your other side advocate, discuss with him, tell him that you can resolve the issue before you go to the long process of court of law and find a resolution. There is no difficulty. By resolving the issue before the case starts, doesn't make your practice diminish. It is, the clients are happy because he says that, yes, my advocate gave me the best relief without wasting my time in the court of law, which may be 10 years, 11 years, whatever it may be. Those days have gone where you say that I'll go up to Supreme Court and I'll win this case. It's not possible. It's not practical. It's not feasible, because when you grow up in your profession, when you become the best person in your profession, you have a lot of work to deal with, and you can't hang on to one case just to get some kind of a benefit out of it. Similarly, you can be a mediator, you can be resolve this issue, but there is another thing that have respect about your fellow advocates. it's not that the other advocates are not knowledgeable as you are. They are also knowledgeable. Maintain their respect, maintain a friendship with them, maintain, nothing goes out of your pocket if you have a good relationship with your fellow advocates as such. You can be a best person in your bar room or your bar association, and you can get the best respect from your fellow advocates. One more thing, that our profession or advocates are termed with an animal called fox. A fox is a very intelligent animal. Marathi madhe tela dhurtapana asa mhantat. You can be a best fox in your profession, but don't never become an hyena. Taras banaychi garaj nahi, you don't become a hyena. And because he hyena believes in what other side has, other persons have left for him. You can be a best person in giving an advice, and you being an officer of the court, you are equally treated good by your fellow advocates as such. One more thing which normally I see whenever I had traveled outside Mumbai, I have gone in some official area or gone to Nagpur or to Delhi or to Aurangabad, we have a kind of a itch. It's a natural thing. Bahar se aaya hai, isko jara do din ghuma lete hai. It doesn't benefit anybody. Whenever a person from outside area comes to your court, don't ask for an adjournment. You are equally busy, he is also equally busy. Not to make him come again and again for a simple one single case. You can argue your case on the same day if at all you are ready with the matter and you don't have any genuine difficulty. You can be very courteous to each other. You can have a professional competition, no problem about it. But you can have a competition in court of law, not outside the court. You should forget your whatever grievances you had in a courtroom. As soon as you come out of the courtroom, you should forget the case, and you can be a best friend with your learned friend, your advocate friend who is representing other side. Now, these are the duties towards court, duties towards other side, duties towards fellow advocates. According to me, there is one more duty, is the duty towards the society. You may not find this in a book. You can take it, it's my addition as such. You are a person with a special status in the society. You owe you some kind of a duty towards the society. It is your social obligation, you being an advocate, it's your social obligation towards the society. You need to stand up at the time of challenges before the society. You need to guide the society at the relevant time for the purpose of leading them in the right path instead of creating a confusion. I'm sure you will remember all these things because you are important. You are a person in a society which are a little bit on a higher pedestal as such. Now, these are the things which normally I tell you in the presentation on professional ethics. There is also a good judgment, which if at all you want to, why it's an old judgment, but if at all you want to refer to it, you can read this judgment because it's nicely worded. And if you don't want to read the entire judgment, only read three paragraphs out of these judgments. The judgment is AIR 9/2011, Supreme Court, page 2101. It is OP Sharma versus High Court of Punjab and Haryana. It's in the best of the words, Justice Sadashivam has expressed what advocates a law officer is expected to do as an advocate. Now, this is so far as the presentation is concerned, but I want to tell you a story before I part. And why I want to tell this story, because I don't want you to forget whatever I said just now. It's a very goody-goody thing, but it's a very relevant thing at the given point of time. The story goes like this. It's a story of a monkey and a lion king. Many of you, if at all have heard me earlier, must have come across this story. You can, if at all you have heard this story, ignore it. But for new persons, I would like to tell you the story. There was a monkey wandering in the jungle, just jumping from one tree to another tree, enjoying his freedom, whatever you call it. And he saw the fox who was about to light his own cigarette. Fox was about to light his own cigarette. Monkey approached him and said, "Hello, friend, how are you? What are you doing? Why you are wasting your time? Why you are wasting your life in this kind of a smoking as such?" He said, "Why?" Fox said, "Why?" He said, "Look at the jungle. Jungle is beautiful. Enjoy the life in jungle. It's beautiful. Come with me. We will roam around the jungle and have this fun." Fox said, "Yes, he's saying something good, right?" He dropped the cigarette, went along with him. Further, they went and they came across, both of them came across some rabbit who was about to tear a tobacco packet or gutka and was about to eat. Again, monkey said, approached him and said, "Friend, what are you doing? Don't get entangled with this kind of a habit of gutka or whatever it may be. Don't waste your time. Jungle is good. It's beautiful. Come along with us. We will enjoy the jungle." Rabbit also agreed and followed both of them. Like this, they came across many animals in the jungle doing something, and they all of them persuaded the other animals that don't do bad thing in life. Enjoy the jungle, enjoy the society. They approached a very dense forest where a lion was resting in the evening, and he was about to relish his drink. All of a sudden, monkey, as usual, jumped forward and said, "Oh, my lord, the king of the jungle, the jungle is beautiful. What you are doing? Don't get involved in intoxication. It's bad for your health. You are a king of the jungle. You have to, we follow you. And therefore, you be magnanimous and come along with us to enjoy the jungle." Lion King said yes. He came forward, dropped his glass, came forward, looked at the monkey from top to bottom, and gave him the hardest slap on his head. The monkey, all of a sudden, because of this attack, fell down and got unconscious. All the animals were amazed to look at the behavior of the Lion King, who is looking at his subject. And all of them asked Lion King, "Why you did this? He was telling you the nice thing to enjoy your life." Lion King said, "Yes, he is right, absolutely right. He came here for the seventh time. And whenever he gets intoxicated with his bhang, he tells me the same story. So therefore, I gave him a slap. Anyway, it's just a joke. Don't hear, neither myself is a monkey, nor Mr. Badbade or anybody else is a Lion King. I told you this story only for this reason, that yes, this was a story, but whatever was earlier I said was not a story. It was real rules of life you have to follow in your career. Wish you the best. Now I invite any answers, questions, for whatever queries you have with you. Mr. Badbade, please."
Hello.
Chetan, please. Yes.
Yes. Sir, it was a very enlightening and motivating speech. It was more of mantras for becoming a successful advocate. Sir, I especially liked the duties, which the way it was presented, and I'm sure that most of the advocates now, especially the young advocates, will open their books, the white book which was given during the Sanat time, and reread the sections.
Good.
Sir, the tips given by you, how to deal with the clients, is written nowhere in the books. So it was a really good tips what you have given to young advocates. Sir, I have received some questions on WhatsApp, which I would like to ask you. My first question is from Mr. Anil. Can the lawyers have his own website, and will it amount to advertisement?
No, there is a distinction between advertisement and the what kind of a material you published on the website. Many of the offices do have a website with the permission of the Bar Council. Initially, whenever the website concept came into vogue as such, at many a time some people asked for permission to open their website. The website can give maximum information about your working, in which court you work, what are your details of practice, or which field you practice as such. But you have to have kind of a limitation, saying that I can assure you best results in this field of law as such. When you are on a website, there is a thin line which you have to keep it in your mind. You can give information about your office, your accessibility, but you can't advertise or your skills in your website. You can advise, no difficulty about it, but there is a complete prohibition so far as the advertisement is concerned.
Okay. So we'll move to the next question. Can a lawyer retain his brief if no fees is paid by the client? This question is asked by Advocate Amita.
Many a times people feel that it is their right to retain the brief. Basically, by law, you can't have any lien on your brief. If your client wants to engage some other advocate, he has every right to do it. So therefore, you can't say that I will not return your papers unless you pay my fees. Of course, you are entitled for your fees. There are different ways to recover your fees. Incidentally, now this question is normally asked in this kind of a session. I'm just giving you a good example how it happened in District Raigad, which is close to Bombay. One of the best of the senior advocates from Raigad district was engaged by government of Maharashtra to oppose the claims of land acquisition in Raigad district. It was a huge project coming up, and there was a necessity for the for the government to have best of the legal knowledge at their hand, and therefore they wanted to have a best of legal advice. So they engaged the senior advocate. He fought all those cases, and it was not that the fees were negotiated and government agreed to pay those fees by resolution, by passing government resolution, because those were the special fees. When the matter got over, as you know, the government runs slow. The government declined to pay his fees for more than 9 years. And the advocate, being a senior advocate, he said, I spent all the time and my efforts in defending the case, which were best of in the interest of the government of Maharashtra, he couldn't say that I want to retain the brief. He did only one thing. He gave notice to government, either you pay my fees or otherwise I am going to court of law. And court of law, not for my fees, I am going to seize a seal, the collector's office, for non-payment of my fees. He took a legal action and government realized they cannot fool around. They had to pay their fees, because if something goes wrong in court of law, the purpose, whatever the reason why I'm telling you this is that there cannot be any lien over the brief for want of, you can recover your fees by any other methods, but you can't retain his documents with you unless the fees are paid. Yes.
Sir, Advocate Anwar wants to know whether Wakalatnama is mandatory for appearing in sessions.
Yes. So far as the advocate is concerned, you just see the form of Wakalatnama, which is in a High Court manual. You can, if at all you are representing your client, you have to have your Wakalatnama authority to represent him in court of law. Without Wakalatnama, you can't argue the case on behalf of your client. Now, if you are asking about the counsel practice, which the normally advocates engage another senior advocate for representing his case, yes, that is permissible. There is no difficulty, but keep it in mind. The person who has filed Wakalatnama has to remain present in the court along with the other advocate who is representing his case. Yes.
Okay. Advocate Anil D'Souza has another question. Whether lawyers abusing, fighting or assaulting on fellow lawyers in the courtroom amounts to misconduct?
Absolutely. It's a serious misconduct and they should be immediately dismissed from profession.
Another question by Advocate C.A. Ashwisha. What if previous advocate is not giving NOC to new advocate? Maybe whatever reasons. Could be balance of fees pending or any other reasons. So what is in this situation?
Yeah, there is a way out provided in civil as well as criminal manual. You can approach the registrar of the court with your client's representation that you want to discharge his earlier advocates and engage new advocate, and registrar or the protonotary or whoever is responsible for authority or even the court of judge can allow you to appear in the court in place of the earlier advocate who has refused to return the papers.
Another question by Advocate Satish Dedia. If a lawyer buys apartment with his builder client, will it amount to professional misconduct?
Yes, you cannot negotiate fees in terms of the kind of a share in the property. You can charge your fees whatever you want to charge, but you can't ask for a share in the profits of the client. It's like I have come across many cases where the advocates have demanded fees on the percentage basis in the matter of land acquisition, in the matter of motor accident. This is not permissible in law. It is not according to Advocates Act, and it amounts to professional misconduct if at all you are asking your fees in percentage or profits in the property of the client.
Sir, we have received another question in the chat box by Pratima. Can an advocate be on a payroll of any company with the benefits of ESIC and the Provident Funds?
If you come across, there are many companies, they are called as in-house lawyers. The in-house lawyers are the persons who work in the legal department of that company or the corporation, like Bombay Municipal Corporation, Mumbai Municipal Corporation, has a battery of advocates. I call, just keep it in mind, just it came to me right now. Let us call all of us as an advocate, because that is the only class of person who can practice law in under the Advocates Act in India. When we call ourselves as a lawyer, we generalize too many. This is my personal opinion. We generalize too many things. So we are advocates. We can be an advocate, in-house advocate for a company. But only thing is, if you are in employment, then you are not in profession. You cannot practice law independently. You have to leave that profession. You have to leave that employment and come into the profession. There is no difficulty.
Sir, there is another question from Rajaram Yamgur. Okay, so this question is not, it's like we are asking you some tips. We come across many situations when some fees is to be collected from clients after the decision. So how to handle such situations?
It's your skill. Absolutely. How your relationship with your client counts on that. If you feel that, yes, you in earlier days of your profession, you face this kind of a problem, no doubt about it. Many a times, some advocates say that you pay my fees first, then I'll appear. But it all depends on your relationship with your client, your confidence with your client. You have to make aware your client that if at all your client feels that you are a result-oriented person and you are demanding fees for that, then it is his reservation according to his perception so far as you are concerned. It is absolutely your legal, your professional skill, not legal skill, your professional skill, how to recover the fees.
I agree, sir. So last question.
One more minute. Yeah. I will add to that. We have very senior advocate, Mr. I can take the name, Mr. Shirish Gupte. He came into practice way back in 73, 74, sometime in that. And he used to tell us a very joke. He had a typical client and he used to tell, his client used to assure him, he was a Muslim client, and he used to say, Saab, aapka paisa maine dood mein rakha hai, dood mein. Dood is a very pak thing. Dood mein rakha hai, aapki fees jaise hi hota hai, main de dunga aapko. So, ek din wo bol gaye, to wo dood pi daalo, aur wo paisa mujhe wapas la ke.
Sir, Advocate Shirish Gupte was with us yesterday in a webinar on the event. Okay. Sir, a question from Mahendra Dalarkar. So, can an advocate run a newspaper as an editor?
No, I don't think so, because it's a full-time employment for him, full-time occupation for him. Advocate, a legal profession, is basically means you are independently available for your profession 24/7. So you can't be engaged in any other activities unless it is an honorary thing. I mean, you can for the name's sake, because of your name, something is charity is going to be done. It's something different, but you can't have remuneration from that kind of a profession.
Sir, Advocate Pradeep Patil wants to know, and I would like to know on that also, that nowadays there are many third party apps which are coming, third party sites which are coming, like Legal Card, Vidya Kara, or any such site. So, is this safe for advocates, or can they give their information on this or advertise their names, their numbers on these third-party legal websites?
No, because as per the advocates, as I said earlier, there is only one class of persons who can practice law. That is advocate, who is graduated in law and who is in profession by virtue of a sanad given to him by Bar Council of the state. It can be a Bar Council of the different state. He may be in Gujarat, he may be in Mumbai, he may be in Goa. But Bar Council of that state gives him sanad, and he can practice law only if he has a sanad. No chartered accountant, no person other than advocate can practice law. That's for sure.
Another question is that a government servant after retirement gets pension. So is he still entitled for the legal profession to practice as an advocate?
Yeah, this is the typical issue which is faced by in a Mofussil area, who shifted to Mofussil area in recent past. He complained to me once that these people who are retired from their employment, they come into law because they have passed LLB. They get sanad because they are not in service and they are doing the law and they are not bothered about their income. So therefore, they have a kind of a undercut practice or underthrow practice, which means that they charge very, very nominal fees, which affect the junior advocates practicing in that court. This is not correct as such, but many a times the elders in the bar have persuaded such persons not to indulge into this kind of a practice as such. So it is for elders of the bar to advise those persons who are doing this kind of a thing.
Another question from Advocate Siddharth Hatarkar. He wants to say that a law officer with the municipality, MCGM, can he work as an advocate in the court?
No, you can read Justice Lodha's judgment in that respect. And Justice Lodha and Justice Bhosle, I suppose, it's a very old judgment which went up to Supreme Court. And it is observed by the court time and again that if you are in employment is a very important term. If you are in the employment, you can't be in a profession. That is the situation. You can be a law officer for a corporation or a company or whatever it may be. You can be an in-house lawyer, but unless you are independent person available for law profession 24/7, you cannot practice law in court.
Sir, I think I've covered all the questions which are relevant. And now I would like to transfer the stage to Advocate Harshad. Harshad, sir.
Yes. Thank you once again, Patil, sir. Sir, I will take a minute of yours to introduce my bar. The reason why I'm introducing that the bar should also know. My bar, sir, especially is of 25 to 35 years of age. Young, very young bar. Even the Pune RERA Practitioners Bar, so also Mumbai RERA Practitioners Bar, is very young and very active bar. Sir, I want them to know, and friends, please note this, that Mr. Patil is the person who, when he was chairman of Bar Council of Maharashtra and Goa, started a program for juniors and youngsters like us under the heading Continuous Legal Education Program, or which is in short called CLIP, which is now being run everywhere. In fact, the concept of present webinar series, which is started by us, is nothing but continuation of vision of Mr. Rajiv Patil of continuous legal education program.
Thank you.
Therefore, we cannot, sir, here clap, and you can hear our sound of we clapping for you. But we really thank you for guiding us, because I must tell this to all these new members of the bar, that when I joined Bombay High Court as youngster, Mr. Patil, I think earlier when the program was to start, Seema Sarnaik madam was also there. So they were unwritten guardians. So whatever happened, we used to go to them. Whatever problems we had, we used to go to them, and they used to look after our problems. And one more aspect which I want Bar to take note of, Sana has well introduced Mr. Patil, but one more important aspect is he has led the Advocates Association of Western India. He is very actively participating in cricket team of our lawyers. That is very important, because he has led our team to victory twice at India level. Please note, India level, when it comes to India level, there are Ranji players who are lawyers and who are playing. So Mr. Patil has taken our team twice to the victory. And apart from that, the oldest bar association, now this is relevant for us because we are the youngest bar association. Sir, before the bar council was formed, and any permission was granted. Bar Association of Arera is the last bar association to have got permission from Bar Council of Maharashtra and Goa. And Mr. Rajiv Patil has been the chairman not only of Bar Council of Maharashtra and Goa, but also president of Advocates Association of Western India, which is the oldest bar association of we can say India also. So he was perfect person to speak on professional ethics and the rules relating to the conduct of an advocate. Sir, we once again thank you, and I request Chetan to hand it over to the next for Thanksgiving.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Harshad. I would now transfer the stage to Advocate Satish to give the thank you note.
Thank you, sir, for your wonderful lecture. Friends, you will rarely find a person whose life suits to his name, and Rajiv Patil, sir, is one of such great personality. Raju means lotus, a sacred flower with multi layers, and sir, like his name, has multi talents and has performed multiple roles in his life. Reading a book or article on professional ethics remained just part of syllabus. Unless we learn it from a person like Rajiv sir, who is actually practicing this ethics in his life, and then such lessons become part of our life. Sir, we are really thankful to you, and we are really lucky to have an opportunity to learn the basic lessons of our profession from you. And I thank you on behalf of our association and our members for giving your valuable time for us. Thank you, sir.
Welcome.
Thank you,
Satish, can you announce tomorrow's lecture?
Yeah.
Second, next lecture, yeah.